Hello, and welcome to the first of this year's live-streamed writing workshops to support the Bruntwood Prize for Playwriting, a partnership between the Royal Exchange Theatre Manchester and property company Bruntwood. The prize is an opportunity for writers of any background and experience to enter unperformed plays for a prize fund totalling £40,000 and development opportunities. I'm April De Angelis, and we're meeting here at Bruntwood's York House to discuss playwriting with these brave writers who are going to introduce themselves.
Hello, I'm Tim.
I'm Becky.
I'm Ben.
I'm Josh.
And I'm Danielle.
I'll be setting some exercises which you can join in with at home, and hopefully they might help not only the writers here in the room, but also you at home in developing your play. And if you have any questions as we're going along, please feel free to tweet them, and there'll be some time at the end for me to answer them. Okay, I'm going to be asking the writers to write a scene today, and I hope you'll write a scene as well. And as we work through the workshop, there'll be various ideas coming up that hopefully you'll be able to keep hold of and use when you're writing your scene. So the first thing that I've asked everyone to do is to look at a scene that's already been written, a section of the first scene in King Lear. And the writers have kindly agreed to read it to us, and they've all got a part. Mm-hmm. And so we're just going to read a little bit of King Lear, and then we're going to talk about why it's a scene and what makes a scene so active and significant for writers. So Lear starts off.
Meantime, we shall express our darker purpose. Give me the map there. Know that we have divided in three our kingdom, and 'tis our fast intent to shake all cares and business from our age, conferring them on younger strengths, while we, unburthened, crawl toward death. Our son of Cornwall, and you, our no less loving son of Albany, we have this hour a constant will to publish our daughter's several dowers, that future strife may be prevented now. The princes, France and Burgundy, great rivals in our youngest daughter's love, long in our court have made their amorous sojourn, and here are to be answered. Tell me, my daughters, since now we will divest us both of rule, interest of territory, cares of state, which of you shall we say doth love us most, that we our largest bounty may extend where nature doth with merit challenge? Goneril, our eldest born, speak first.
Sir, I love you more than word can wield the matter, dearer than eyesight, space and liberty, beyond what can be valued rich or rare, no less than life with grace, health, beauty, honour, as much as child e'er loved or father found. A love that makes breath poor and speech unable, beyond all manner of so much I love you.
What shall Cordelia speak, love and be silent?
Of all these bounds, even from this line to this, with shadowy forests and with champagnes riched, with plenteous rivers and wide-skirted meads, we make thee, lady. To thine and Albany's issues be this perpetual. What says our second daughter, our dearest Regan, wife of Cornwall?
I am made of that self-metal as my sister, and prize me as her worth. In my true heart I find she names my very deed of love, only she comes too short, that I profess myself an enemy to all other joys which the most precious square of sense possess, and find that I alone felicitate in your dear highness's love.
Then poor Cordelia, and yet not so, since I am sure my love's more ponderous than my tongue.
To thee and thine, hereditary ever, remain this ample third of our fair kingdom, no less in space, validity, and pleasure, than that conferred on Goneril. Now, our joy, although our last and least, to whose young love the vines of France and milk of Burgundy strive to be interest, what can you say to draw a third more opulent than your sister's? Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond, no more nor less.
How, Cordelia? Mend your speech a little, lest you may mar your fortunes.
Good, my lord. You have begot me, bred me, loved me. I return those duties back as our right fit. Obey you, love you, and most honour you. Why have my sister's husbands, if they say they love you all? Happily, when I shall wed, that lord whose hand must take my plight shall carry half my love with him, half my care and duty. Sure, I shall never marry like my sisters, to love my father all.
But goes thy heart with this?
Aye, my good lord.
So young and so untender.
So young, my lord, and true.
Let it be so. Thy truth then be thy dower. For by the sacred radiance of the sun, the mysteries of Hecate and the night, by all the operation of the orbs from whom we do exist and cease to be, here I disclaim all my paternal care, propinquity and property of blood, and as a stranger to my heart and me, hold thee from this for ever. The barbarous Scythian, or he that makes his generation messes to gorge his appetite, shall to my bosom be as well neighboured, pitied and relieved, as thou, my sometime daughter.
Good, my liege.
Peace, Kent. Come not between the dragon and his wrath. I loved her most, and thought to set my rest on her kind nursery. Hence, and avoid my sight.
Thank you. So this is the sort of centre of the first scene. Let's just talk a little bit about how it works. When Lear, what does Lear expect to happen? Do you think?
He wants them all to compete over who loves them most.
Yes, and in a sense, he's devised this ritual, hasn't he? It's in a public place. I think it's what's really interesting about it, though. It has these. It's always, because it's a personal, it's like a family dynamic, but put into, you know, the world of a kingdom and a court, it's always, there was always going to be some kind of underlying tension there. So it's a really clever scene in a way, because it's asking for public acknowledgements from people who you have a private and personal relationship with. So there was always that sort of opposite in the scene. And I think opposites is a word that we should, you know, pay attention to. So he expects them all to agree with him, and he expects that the ritual shall just continue of him dividing it into three and giving the biggest portion to Cordelia. So the conflict is between Lear and Cordelia in this scene, and that's the point at which the play kind of comes alive, doesn't it? Because she refuses him. She refuses, and she, at that moment, kind of really, she breaks the ritual. She presents an obstacle to what he wants. And it's really interesting, the scene kind of sort of snarls up, it sort of stops, it comes to nothing. I mean, literally, at that point. There's how many nothings? Six, five nothings. Why is that, do we think? It's interesting because of the rhythm of the scene. Actually, at the point which I think you'd call the reversal, would you? We know that the sense where something unexpected but logical happens. That's what Aristotle calls a reversal. That's the point where the whole ritual and the rhythm of the scene stops, and it kind of trips up on this word nothing, and it gets insist again as if it can't be absorbed. It sort of sits on top of the scene, and the word can't kind of, all the other words are sort of just in a flowy, sort of flowy thing, aren't they? And then you get this word that's sort of like a jolt in the program, in a sense. And then you get this repetition that won't, and it's sort of, because it snarls up there, it can't be reintegrated into the scene. And that's the point. At which, you know, he asks her again, and she still won't submit. And then you get the her defiance.
I think that kind of conflict then opens up the central conflict, maybe the rest of the play.
Yeah, absolutely.
Power and money and love and what those kind of things.
Yeah.
Mean.
Yeah, but it also, it's really interesting about the central character having kind of an expectation of what's going to happen. And that when that expectation's not met, because there's a conflict in the scene, and they're prevented from achieving their objective, you have this, you have a kind of sense that there's a gap opening up, don't you, between between what they thought was going to happen and what in fact does happen. And like often, if you read a scene, often there's a pause at that moment. I mean, Shakespeare hasn't got a pause. He's just got this reiteration, nothing, 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 which is a bit like a pause, because nothing happens in a pause, doesn't it? But that's the kind of, that's the sort of story gap, isn't it? Because if she'd said, yes, I love you just as much as my sisters, more, you know, fine, he'd have divided it up and nothing, the play would kind of be over. But the resistance, the conflict, is what makes the scene kind of prize open and allows story to come through. I mean, I've noticed that, you know, ambition, honesty, women's writing for women was one of the things that I'd written that this was about. And I think it's quite interesting that that Cordelia is a woman character. Why is she, who's saying no to a very powerful male figure? And she's providing the main conflict, in a sense. And I think that's just worth thinking about when, you know, if you're writing, when you're writing great female characters, or you want to not to have them, to have them right at the centre of the conflict, and in a sense, going against type, because speaking publicly and declaring, refusing to accept the voice of authority in the play is quite a good way of starting to think about, I think, all characters maybe, but maybe specifically women characters. And she's also, I mean, there's also something about a kind of natural, something unnatural in the play, isn't there, with, well, I think it's also, which is part of the conflict, like, is he asking something, is his request proper? Do you know what I mean? Does it feel natural, or is it unnatural? And is she behaving in a natural way or an unnatural way? I mean, he names her as unnatural, but maybe she's being natural. But you know, we talked about oppositions in earlier on. That's another opposition, I think, in the play, between natural and unnatural, as well as the private and the public. And and you know, if you can find a conflict which allows those oppositions to be, a lot of oppositions to be mobilised, you're kind of creating a lot of energy for your play. And one of the words that, you know, about this workshop was ambition. And I think maybe that's, you know, people speaking out in ways they're not supposed to, as well as kind of looking at these sort of big oppositions that can be mobilised in a conflict, is quite ambitious, I think. Is there anything else that anybody noticed about that section?
It was just interesting that you said that about ambition.
Yeah.
Because you feel very much that Goneril and Regan are the ambitious ones by doing this performative thing.
Yes, yes.
Where really, like, Cordelia almost has like a bigger ambition
truthful. Yes, that's right. She does have an ambition to be truthful. And I think another thing to kind of notice about a scene is masks, you know. They wear a mask, the other two characters, and she's refusing to do that, which is, so there's that's that, you know, the sense of honesty that's liberated by that. But it's also, so looking at the moment of conflict as well, which I think is really interesting for a scene, and the moment of reversal, where an expectation's closed down and, you know, the story opens up. There's quite a lot of... it liberates emotion as well, I think, doesn't it? Because when you're in a ritual, the whole point of a ritual, I think, is to contain emotions in some way, to make them safe, and to think, well, this is what you do on your birthday. It's always, you know, those threshold days when you think, oh my God, I'm a year older, or what have I done with my life in the last year, or whatever. And so you have this thing where, it's okay, because we're going to a wine bar, and people are going to give me cards, and I'm going to be the centre of attention for a day, and it's all going to feel fine, and that's the ritual. But when you break a ritual, what happens is it's almost like you're allowing all this unfettered emotion to come out. And in Lear's case, it's kind of this anger, this awful anger. It's the crisis, as you pointed out. It is also that it's always a crisis in a scene, isn't it? When a new piece of information enters the world of the protagonist. And it means that the world is not what they thought. It's literally sort of slipping away from them. And then, of course, they then have to cope with the consequences of that, which creates more action. But there's equilibrium's affected, which is another really good word. I think on a sort of philosophical level, it sort of asks, well, what is the world then? How do we know the world? You know, when something goes awry like that, what's the truth? I mean, So I think that one of the things I'm sort of trying to stress is that when you just thinking about scenes in that way, they're doing so much, and trying to think really in terms of writing scenes and what particular scenes liberate is really, you know, I mean, I'm just a great advocate of trying to think in those terms about what it is that, you know, what the conflict is and how that conflict releases the crisis of the piece. There's also, I suppose, one other thing. I mean, do you think in terms of obstacles and objectives and what they want? Because it's, if you were going to say, well, what are they for Lear and Cordelia? Is anyone bear to have a go at what they think? What does Lear want?
Well, I mean, risking repeating what you've just said, but in terms of the ritual, there's a certain expectation.
Yeah.
Clearly, he wants his daughters to show him love.
Yeah.
Obviously, the stakes are so high because out of all those daughters, it's Cordelia
most
that he wants.
Yeah.
To show affection.
Yes, he does, and what's?
But he also wants to be unburdened from. He wants to be relieved of his responsibilities as a ruler.
Yes.
That's his, but
he is also trying to rule her at the same time, isn't he? He's trying to kind of, to control her in a way, as well as wanting her to love him, to give him a word of her love. And, what stops him getting that? What is it that stops him? What's the obstacle to him?
Cordelia.
Yeah, and what does she want?
She wants to tell the truth.
She wants to tell the truth. And she wants, she doesn't, I don't think she, it's not that she wants to not to love him, because I think, weirdly, they both want to love each other in a way.
She wants to be truthful to her love, doesn't she? She wants to describe her love in a way that is accurate.
Yes.
And her sisters are describing their love.
Yes, and without a mask.
Accurate. Yeah, she wants to honestly describe her love for her father.
Yeah. Which is bounded in some way. She says, you know, why does my sisters, why do they have husbands if they love you all? But I suppose the point is that what people want has to be available from other people in the scene, doesn't it? I mean, if Lear wanted to, build a pyramid, say, I mean, well, that's not a worthwhile objective for him to have within that scene, because it has to be, both the obstacles and the objectives sort of have to be in the scene. Good. All right. So, hopefully, you've kind of taken some notes about what's the kind of elements that we're going to be using for scenes. Do you think, just as a thought, a little bit of a thought, there's something as Lear and Cordelia enter the scene as characters, you feel like. One of the things, the event of the scene, which is Lear asking his daughters to love him, how much they love him so he can divide up the scene, that's the kind of event of the scene, and her refusal as well being part of that event. But you get a sense that that they have characters before, in the first part of the scene, they're one kind of character. And after that event, after that eruption, after that crisis, it's as if their characters have changed, or something's emerging from them. So there's a sense in the scene, isn't there, where they have an established character, an established identity. And there's something about the crisis in the scene creating a new identity for those characters in some way, or something emerging. And certainly... I mean, I think one of the things that's overturned in the scene is that women are always supposed to be irrational, and actually Cordelia is very rational in this scene, and men are always supposed to be, traditionally and like Shakespeare's time, men are supposed to be rational, and actually what you see kind of emerging from Lear is something kind of irrational. But, so, you know, what Cordelia enters the scene as a kind of an obedient daughter, but that crisis throws her kind of identity and some kind of into crisis, and she can't be, she can be a true daughter or an honest daughter, but she can't be obedient anymore. And it kind of cuts her free from the family in some way. So I think it's just really interesting to think about, you know, another thing that a scene does through its crisis is it starts to alter the identity of the characters in it. And I think possibly, you know, a whole play, what you're really watching is, in one of the things you're watching is the arc of a character, how identity is shifting for a character, because it's impossible to be contained anymore, and how over through the various crises in the play, the reversals, because what we see, we just read in that scene is a reversal of expectations, and new kind of identities emerging. And I think that's sort of what plays are really, really good at tracing. But anyway, for a writer to get to the point of writing these characters and writing these stories and writing these crises, the first thing a writer has to do, in a sense, is get in touch with something emotional, I think. So in a sense, you know, when you have a scene, the sort of stuff we've been talking about, the kind of structure of a scene in a way, is like rational. It is quite a rational thinking. It's the part of a writer that has to work on the material or the emotions and the ideas that you have. But I mean, I think the first thing I've asked you all to bring is a piece of an article that made you feel angry. And I just wondered if, you know, that's a good starting point for you to try and find something that engages you and enrages you. And it's interesting that Lear's an angry character. What I'd like to do now is for people just to share, for us all to share our, well, I haven't got one, obviously, but for you guys just to share your article and talk a little bit why it made you angry.
Should I?
Okay. Yes, okay, brilliant.
I bought the Daily Telegraph because I thought something in that would make me angry. And the one I picked out is, it's head solution to oversubscribed school, break new rules and you'll be expelled. And basically, a headmaster of a school, he's got too many pupils in it.
Yeah.
And so he's unashamedly emailed, there were some leaked emails, but he's since claimed that he's happy that they've been leaked, this is how it works.
Yeah.
He's set some new rules and he's going to be really strict and he's going to aim to try and expel, so he's 25 over, so he wants to expel at least 25 students by the end of next year.
Wow.
So I was like, that's ridiculous.
Yes, yeah. And why do you think did it make you feel angry? I mean...
Yeah, because it's one of them occasions where somebody's not thinking about, like, the individuals or the students.
Yes.
He's just thinking about this big mechanism of the school and, oh, no, there's too many people in it.
Yes.
Let's get rid of them without thinking of the consequences of that. And then to then be like, he was like, it is oversubscribed and I did send the emails, it's, you know, this is entirely reasonable. And he's just no apology from that.
Yes. And what where do you place yourself as if imaginatively in that story? Do you, place yourself, as the headmaster? Where do you, because to be angry in a sense, you sort of almost have to position yourself, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Who, are you a parent? Are you a pupil? Are you a...
Yeah. I could definitely, you know, see myself as, say, like an idealistic teacher who wants to put the pupils first.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, as angry as it does make me, you know, the school is oversubscribed.
Yes.
And he is the head teacher and he's got to think about the school
of
as a
course.
Whole. But at the same time, it's a very callous way of going
about
it.
So you'd, in a sense, one of the characters that's kind of emerging from that is as an idealistic teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering now, like, what's at the heart of an idealistic teacher? You know, is there an experience that teachers had themselves that's what's made them idealistic?
Maybe coming from a background that didn't have the best education, and has decided these kids will.
Yes, yeah. So in a way, you could say that there's a kind of a wound in a way in that idealistic teacher, in a sense. because they've been a child that's maybe had to struggle in education or seen other people or been in an environment where other people have been given more than they have, or there's some sense of a wound there, isn't there?
Mm-hmm.
Possibly. Do people sort of agree with that as an idea? So, I mean, what's interesting about that is that what's the story, you know, what's the story of that, that idealism? And why, and this present situation, it's interesting now, talking about it, is that this present situation is kind of igniting an old, unresolved wound or mm-hmm. anger or pain or something, or a sense of injustice.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if you were going to build on that story, one of the things you might do is to kind of, like, just try and understand what that might be. And it might be actually something in your own life, or it might be perhaps that's drawn you to that story. I mean, I think writers have to sort of, in a way, one of our jobs is to go, well, why am I interested in it? At the same time, as you also kind of reading around, sort of investigating the subject, researching it, you know, what is an idealistic teacher? I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? Because if you talk to playwrights, they'll always, or like I was thinking about Harold Pint, you know, loving his teacher, you know, being incredibly, how significant teachers are for people. Anyway, yeah, that's great. And it does seem really crazy. So well done. As we're doing the workshop, just kind of make a few notes and think about what that character might be. How about you? What did you have?
I chose an article about the gig economy, partly because the expression gig economy enrages me, and the idea that it's kind of presented as kind of a young, hip thing,
uh-huh.
no job security, and that...
Oh, I don't know what the gig economy is.
You work for companies like Deliveroo and Uber, and they don't have to pay a minimum wage, and they're not unionised, and they work very flexible.
Yes.
After social hours. But I think the other reason that I found myself getting quite angry is I found myself getting quite angry with myself because I'm quite right on, and I use all those companies.
Right.
Knowing
that
they aren't very well in ways that I might be shopping for fair trade chocolate, but actually still takeaway.
And did you actually feel angry with yourself?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
And why though, do you think? Just...
Because I guess it encapsulates that conflict between kind of wanting to be in the modern world and wanting to have easy food delivered to my door that tastes nice, but also wanting to...
Yeah. And so where do you picture yourself if in that story as imaginatively? Are you the person turning up with a pizza or are you the person opening the door? I mean, how do you...
Imaginatively, I think it might be nice, interesting to be the person turning up with a pizza and being part of the circumstances maybe
Do you think there could be a relationship between the person that's turning up and the person? I mean, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's kind of this person coming to your home, and it's kind of...
There's a recognition.
I mean, I do get delivery quite a
lot.
Oh,
do
lot,
you?
But it's
oh, really? Do you feel...
It's like a different person every time.
Oh, is it? But you never... Does it make you feel guilty, or... Do you know what I mean?
Well, it will do now.
I mean, I'm just thinking, has there ever been an encounter with somebody where you've sort of felt a bit... uneasy, or it's triggered, or is it always very clean and you close the door? Has there ever been a moment where...
Well, they've woken the children up and I've been irritated.
Oh, really?
Kind of like,
okay.
How they knock on my door so loudly.
Okay.
Yeah, so I guess there's that thing that you're letting someone into your home is quite interesting.
Yes.
Yeah,
and who are they?
Yeah.
So in a way there's
I've only just remembered this and it's awful, but I had to do
You're not horrible.
I had someone drop something off from a delivery company,
yeah.
And I was really sort of flustered and not paying them any attention. And he was my old next door neighbour and was really like, "Hello, how are the children?" And I was like, "Who are you?"
Wow, that's amazing. Right, so that's interesting, isn't it? So what is your duty towards somebody like that? You know, because you kind of know them, but it's not. It's not really part of the relationship, isn't it? Someone just knocking the door. So that's quite interesting. As well as the kind of, the other story you told about being annoyed about the child, somebody who's actually doing you a job for you, but then waking the kids up. I mean, it's almost like if those two people were the same person. I think it's interesting, isn't it? Rather than strangers, always. Yeah. Like, you know, we look in King Lear, you know, because it's a family, That's why it's so explosive. I mean, I think Aristotle says this, you know, if you're going to, that's why the Greeks wrote about the family all the time. Because you can't walk away from your family, and you can't walk away from the, when you know somebody, like, you know, it's your next door neighbour, for example. You have those kind of, they kind of interpolate you in a way, don't they? They make demands of you that you can't, that feel like human demands, duties, and then it really complicates the drama, doesn't it? It's much, much harder to negotiate what your responsibility towards someone is when you've known them in another. But I think as well that it's a very sort of now issue, isn't it? The 0 hours, the Deliveroo, the Amazon. I mean, I'm always thinking, well, I mustn't use Amazon. Oh, I really need that book though. You know, I mean, it is. It's a, which is interesting because it means there's a kind of fault line there that we're all negotiating all the time, which means there's a kind of urgency to tell that story sort of now in a way. So that's a really good, well done. Okay.
Okay. So mine was a story that I saw on social media a few days ago, actually, but it was picked up. It was in The Guardian yesterday about a woman who has been deported after her leave to remain lapsed.
Right.
Because she was going home to Singapore to care for dying parents, and she's been married to a British man for 27 years or something, and they've just kind of deported her and sent her back to Singapore with, like, you know, nothing, like just the clothes on her back and like £12 in her pocket.
Terrible.
Yeah.
And where do you position yourself in that story, in a sense? If you were thinking about it imaginatively, would you be the woman being sent back? Would you be the man that's left behind? Would you be the person at the security at the airport, or I don't know, I'm just thinking, you wouldn't be that probably. I mean, I'm just thinking, well, you know, why is it really making you angry? Who do you actually how does it resonate with you, sort of?
Well, I suppose it resonates because it seems to be, you know, an example of an increasingly sort of anti immigration stance being taken by the government, and increasingly
yes.
sort of like hardline.
Yes.
So it's, I suppose it makes me sort of fearful what we're becoming as a country.
Right.
And
okay.
I think that we're sort of, by having that attitude towards immigration, we're impoverishing ourselves as a country, as a community. You know. You know, I think we're stronger and more beautiful through diversity, and I think, you know, the more we try to shut out foreigners,
yes,
people,
yes,
like, you know, that.
So, I mean, that sort of suggests a personal relationship that's that could be explored between somebody who's being sent away and some. Deported and somebody who's really attached to them, and I mean, is that something you'd be interested in writing about, or?
Yeah, I suppose so. I don't know. It was just the first thing.
Yeah,
caught my eye.
It's interesting because it's a bit like you know, that interdict of the of Lear in a way. You know, this is the law. There's no way you can speak out against it. I mean, that's kind of there is something enraging about, I know Lear's a really angry, enraged person, but his kind of absolute, the power that cannot be negotiated with is something in that story, isn't there?
Yeah,
like Lear, that is actually really kind of enraging. What is that thing? What does it mean when you can't be, you can't tell the story doesn't kind of stand, can't be rescued, it's got to be,
it's so petty as well, it's so arbitrary, and
what do you think I mean, is the story then about what that might drive people to? Power is petty and arbitrary. I mean, does it drive your character to act in a certain way? I'm just thinking about, you know, what's the kind of emotional needle that's in there for your if you if you were positioned as the woman's husband. I don't know. Maybe you were the woman. I don't know how you would. But if you were, is there some sort of trajectory there about what you do when power is so unreasonable?
Yeah. I mean, so the first one that I found before we just started was slightly tongue in cheek. So as we've been around...
you can have a tongue in cheek.
No, because then I was thinking, like, what actually has made me angry recently? Because I just think that most time when I read articles, like a newspaper or online, they don't actually make me angry, because whilst they're, like, really, really bad things that are taking place, I can understand why it's taking place. Or I can put it in the context of, it's the Daily Mail, so you're making me angry because you're the Daily Mail. And that's sort of their job. But the one thing that... did make me angry, and I'm sure it's like a story that everyone will be familiar with, was the one the other week with Donald Trump banning, was it CNN, the BBC, and a few others. And I think that makes me angry, because I can't rationalise that. I can't in my head work out, oh, they've done that for this, that and the other reason.
Yes.
Think in terms of like a narrative way in,
yeah,
I think that'd be something really interesting for me to try and somehow work out how it's justifiable, or how I can say, yes, that's how you get to that point.
How you get to the point of being completely irrational.
Of saying it's acceptable to ban kind of respected, trusted news organisations for a press conference.
Yeah. But you're angry, but in a way, what made you feel engaged or enraged or was the silencing, wasn't it? The idea that somebody can silence or ban something. I mean, isn't that what grabbed you in that story?
Yeah, I suppose it is, yeah.
And were going to imaginatively like position yourself in, if it was a narrative or a play, who would you be in it?
I think it'd be probably one of the advisors to someone say, oh yeah, this is what we should do. I imagine there are people within his team that are saying, well, this is not acceptable. Like, you know, we're meant to be the sort of spearhead of liberal democracy, and then there will be other advisors that say, no, absolutely, we should ban the BBC. This is the best thing to do. And so I think it could play, it's like one of the advisors that's somewhere between those would be dramatically the most interesting, or at least then you've got tension between those two sides.
Yeah, I'm just wondering what's your sort of, so you're writing from a position of almost like annoying the audience in a way, provoking us by your arguments about, you know, legitimising something like that. But where's your sort of...
I think for me it'd be trying to work out how you can get to a point where these kind of things are acceptable. How as a society can we say...
Yeah.
And it happens and we go, oh, that's a shame.
Yeah.
It's bad.
Do you think it's like that there are talking about... Because we've been talking about anger and people being driven mad in a way like Lear is. Yeah. I mean, is there something about why people get to the point of accepting that kind of... How angry people must be to
like
accept
how can you be apathetic by that sort of thing? Yeah.
Well, and how can you embrace it? You know, because presumably there are people that embracing that. How do they get to that level of anger?
Mm-hmm.
And then you are left with these very... I mean, in a sense, we are dealing with very angry people. If you're going to write a character that's against that, you're also going to be thinking about the characters that are kind of engaging, wanting that as well. I mean, that's quite a explosive situation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, how about you?
Mine's a little bit heavy, but I read it, so I read this article and then someone kind of stayed with me throughout, so I thought I'd talk about this. It was a story about a woman that was killed in like a murder-suicide. And the article that I picked up was about how she'd kind of gone invisible, so she'd kind of become invisible throughout the news coverage. And she'd been kind of known as this invisible woman, and the whole kind of narrative, if you like, of the story and what happened was about the husband and how he was this great man, and she kind of completely lost all sense of character. There was no voice for her, and just the way that story was told, it really kind of, you know, upset me, and it made me really angry as well that, you know, she was left as this voiceless person, and like I said, the story was just, the narrative was just a completely different way of it being told, so I picked
So she was murdered by her husband.
Yeah, so she was killed by him, and it was her and the children, and
yes.
And it was in a small town. Yes. And all the kind of newspapers were talking about how he was such a wonderful man and how could he do that, and she hardly got any kind of mention.
Yes.
And it wasn't until someone had said, you know, this woman was a woman and she existed and she had a name.
Yes.
Because she had, like I said, just kind of, they called her the invisible woman because they just completely...
Yes, yes, yes. Now that is really, I mean, that's kind of awful silencing and distortion. And also then the violence never gets addressed in that story,
doesn't it?
Because the man is kind of heroised in a way.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a little bit, it's interesting, isn't it? Because if Cordelia had just gone along with Lear, she would have been kind of silenced in a way and kind of invisible. Her story would never have happened. So in a story like that, where would you position yourself kind of in terms of if you were going to write that narrative?
Well,
where would you...
I guess the reason I was so angry was because she didn't have a voice. So I thought that, you know, the really important thing was for her to tell her story and have a voice within, you know, that.
Yeah. So somehow to either through a character that's like her, that's going through her experiences, to try and investigate what it's... almost like what it's like to be a woman in those experiences.
Yeah.
Do you think that's the would be a way of doing that?
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Okay, so now let's us look at... You've also brought a picture as well, haven't you, of a character that you found. And so people at home can't actually see these pictures, but can you describe your... Maybe we should start with you, because we'd started...
Yeah. Because my story was quite heavy, I chose a lighter picture. So I picked a woman from one of those magazines you get from Holman Barrett, the healthy magazine, and she's wearing a face mask. So she's got her hair tied back, and she's got a kind of grey face mask on, and she's looking at the camera.
That's interesting, because that's sort of really like your invisible woman, isn't it?
Yeah.
She's sort of been obliterated by this mask.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Thing.
She didn't. Maybe that was subconsciously made.
Yeah, that's interesting. How about you?
I don't know how to describe this.
About
the fact he's wearing makeup and he's a rapper and he's got this kind of interesting bit of jewellery.
Yeah.
It's quite a strong look.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just the magazine that happened to be next to my bed this morning.
Yeah.
Open, I thought that's
Yeah. And can you see any connection between that and your story about people being silenced? I mean, he has actually got his finger over his mouth, hasn't he?
I mean, yes, in terms of the article that I've read, it kind of links to that. But yeah, in terms of the thing on his mouth, somehow, like, there's definitely a subversive element to him wearing makeup.
Yeah.
Being a man.
Yeah. Great. Lovely.
I can't find any other.
No, that's
fine.
You don't have
to.
I just want to see what they are.
We'll
do a bit more work on them in a minute.
Yeah.
That's great. How about you?
I just found this image from the same edition of the paper that I got the story from.
Uh-huh.
But it's from the Sony World Photography Awards.
Yeah.
And it's a young girl in Armenia. Sort of taking shelter amidst sort of rusty car parts and just kind of gazing into the middle distance it's the caption says her father had reportedly killed himself 10 days earlier, but it doesn't say why or what the situation. I don't really know much about the situation in Armenia, I'm afraid, but I don't know, it just struck, there was just something about her expression and the sort of the framing of the shot that really kind of just sort of grabbed me.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit like a stage set, isn't it? Because it's almost like she's built out of this, she's in a kind of hull of a car or something, and she's sitting there, that's like a sort of roof.
Mm.
And she's got she's sort of a little numb. I mean, she's quite noble looking, but she looks numb.
Yeah.
But it does, do you see any resonance with your... the story that you told about somebody being deported or...
We're just kind of trying to make the connections, you know, and the sort of the fact that this woman who was deported had, you know, two sons and a granddaughter who lived, you know, here, and that family being sort of ripped apart by this kind of petty bureaucracy. And
and of course people are deported back to war zones, of course, they're sent places that are unsafe. I mean, it's interesting, she's so alone, isn't she, as well? And she's a, how old would you say she is?
She's 9.
Right. Yeah, okay, great, thanks. How about you?
I chose this girl, she's a 17, 18 year old girl playing football, and I just liked it because she's kind of just on her game and really determined.
Yeah.
Picking up, she's in something.
Yeah, she looks really, as you say, active, and it's not a typically feminine picture, is it, in that sense? She's really, you know, taking part right in the middle of a sport. Is there any connection between your story and...
Well, I was just thinking about that.
It doesn't have to be.
And I was thinking about the things, and like she's maybe 17, 18, and the things you sort of want when you're young for what you want to be and what you want to do when you grow up, and then how you end up working at a rubbish
that's
job,
interesting.
Riding a bike to some middle-passage house.
Right, okay. So that could be an incarnation of your character, perhaps.
Maybe.
Perhaps. Lovely, yeah. How about you?
So mine is a picture of an older woman who's just got this impossible smile. It's just like smeared across her face. She's like clutching a handbag, looking on. She looks quite proud.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And is there any way? Is there any? It doesn't have to be, but is there any possible connection?
I mean, I was going to say no, but she really reminds me of, we had this like reception school teacher who was called Mrs. Fairy, but we all called her Mrs. Fairy because she was just like impossibly lovely, and she was, you know, just like the ideal teacher, and she used to give you like extra biscuits and cartons of milk.
Right.
And there was never anyone else quite like her, but I don't know.
Well, that's quite interesting. So it could be your, because we were talking about ideal teachers, weren't we?
Mm-hmm.
And how that she might be that. Ideal teacher.
Yeah, I mean, when you're 4 years old and you just get given a biscuit,
yes.
You're in love.
I know. Much difficult later on, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Good.
Although biscuits they're still good. Okay, right. So, what I'm going to ask you to do now, I'm going to ask you to do a task, and the task is about creating five questions you would like to ask your a character. And the character I want you to either choose a character that you talked about when you talked about your brought your article, or a character that you have in your photograph, or maybe, as we were talking about, how sometimes, strangely, that they've kind of morphed into one, or that they may be... that in some way there's a connection between the article you read and the character that you bought. But I just want you to, it's almost like a group exercise, like, okay, if you're going to think, how am I going to get to know these characters better? What do I need to know? I'm going to think of five questions, and everyone's question is going to apply to everyone's character, okay? So I'm just going to give you like 3 minutes, and that's a task that we're going to do. So we'll be... just working on that for about 3 minutes, and there'll be a little break for 3 minutes. Hi, welcome back. So I've just asked the writers to think of five questions they might ask of their character that they're developing. They probably haven't got a very clear, particularly clear idea. It's probably like a hazy, it's what Peter Brooks would have called like a hunch about a character. And so these questions are there to try and focus who this person might be. So they've either chosen a person from their article, a person that was inspired by their article, they bought them, made them angry, or just a picture of a character that grabbed their attention, or some kind of fusion of the two. It doesn't matter, there's sort of no right or wrong about it. But and these questions are just trying to, as if you're kind of adjusting a camera lens and trying to get a kind of clearer picture. So everyone can ask their five questions, and they're for everyone else to jot down a little answer to yourself, so that you are using the other people's questions to help focus your character, as well as thinking about your own questions for your own character. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. So it's basically just reading out your questions. So who would like to go first? We start this end.
Okay, my five questions are, number one, when did you decide on this career? Number two, how are you going to make a difference? Number three.
Give people a little time to answer the question. Just like a little pause in between.
Number three, are you being honest with yourself? Number four, who are you putting first? And number five, what are you willing to sacrifice?
I have a, what did you want to be when you grow up? What are you frightened of? At what moment in your day are you happiest? Who or what makes you feel safe? And what makes you angry?
Had enough time to answer those? Okay. No.
I've just written them down.
Oh, good. Yes. Okay.
I didn't get five questions either, but the ones that I did get were, what will you do now? What do you remember from the last time you were here? How has this place changed?
Very interesting, because they sort of really place the character in a real embodied place, don't they, those questions? Mm. Which is a good question, you know, where is your character now?
Mm. My five are, who would you most like to respect you? Two, what do you regret the most? Three, when was the last time you lied and did not get away with it? Four, what is your biggest insecurity? And five, is there anything you don't feel able to tell the person closest to you?
These are great questions.
Number one, what is your darkest secret? Number two, what do you want or need? Number three, where do you live? Number four, what's your earliest memory? Number five, how do you feel about the person closest to you?
So just looking at, do people feel like they've got a character that's kind of beginning to sort of be there? Mm-hmm. Something that you can work with? Sort of? Not really.
No. I'll get there.
I think the thing is that you're going to, for the sake of this exercise, try and go, okay, you know, make... get on side with your character, try and crystallise something. Just say for the, I mean, you can use your photo if you like. What I want you to do is just to have a look at what you've got so far in your questions. And I want you to think about the questions that arise from that. What do you need to know? Now you know these questions, the answers to these questions. What question do they beg? And I just want you to think of like three questions that you need answered now with what you know of your character. It might be, and I would also like you to give your character a name. Further questions? Okay. Welcome back. We're now going to hear the next set of questions that were inspired by the first set of questions to get to know these characters that we're developing a bit better. So, should we start your end?
Yeah. My three are... shall I read them really slowly so you've got time? Yeah,
and also give people a little bit of time to think, to write. Just a pause so they can write their answer.
Mm-hmm. Okay. When did it all go wrong? The next one is, where are your family? And the next one, the last one, is why did you lie?
Great. Did you have a name for your character?
I did, but I don't really think she fits it. I've called her Sienna, but I don't think she looks like a Sienna. So that might change.
All right. Great.
So the things that I need to know about this character are, what is your day job? What is your day job? The second question I need to know the answer to is, what is your favourite website? excluding social media. And the third question I need to know the answer to is, why do you think you are so lonely?
Yeah. It's interesting whether a character blames himself or the world. It's quite interesting.
Yeah, I thought there was more questions. Why would other people say that? Or,
yes.
Yeah, there's quite a few questions. I think,
It's interesting how when you answer one question, other questions are kind of come forward. You know, it's just, I suppose that's what this exercise is about. It's just like finding a character is almost like a never-ending series of questions in a way. And in fact, that's what plays are. They're question after question after question. How about you?
Sorry, I got a bit stuck. I'm really
All right,
the next questions.
All right, then.
I had, what's a typical day for you? And then, this isn't very articulately expressed, but something like, what is it you can't forgive yourself for?
Right. Yeah.
And then what do you want to happen now?
Great. Did you have a name?
Jenny.
Jenny. Did you have a name?
David.
David. No? Do you have a name?
Okay, my three questions were, one, did you have any friends when you were younger? Two, do you have any friends now? And then number three, I don't know how universal this is, but what was it like to return?
So what I'm going to do now is ask you to think about writing a scene. Now, this scene can, you can write this about your character. It could be a scene involving your character. In fact, it would be good if it was a scene involving your character. But I want you to think in terms of, and if your character's not clear yet, then perhaps like thinking about the structure of a scene in the way we talked about the King Lear scene might, in a sense, the demands that thinking about that structure might encourage you to make some decisions or invent a character out of perhaps even the slightest hints that you have in your questions. Or maybe just looking at your picture as if you're stuck. But I think some of you, it seems to me as if you're beginning to kind of grow a character and have a sense of who they are. Does anyone want to, just before that, anyone want to venture to talk a little bit about their character? Does anyone want to talk a little bit about who they are? They've managed to make a bit of a...
I could...
You would you? Yeah, it'd be great, actually.
Very vague.
Very vague, yeah.
But I kind of zoned in on the idea of the idealistic teacher. And then I just realised how, perhaps the wrong word, but how ruthless she was becoming. And I was looking at what her priorities were, and I'm picturing this teacher, and she went to this school when she was a kid. She's come back now under the guise of, you know, she's going to fix everything. And just about the personal conflict that she would have with the head teacher. But I also imagine her living at home, because obviously she's come back, so maybe she's living with her mum or her dad, and there's the tension there of, you know, she's not quite earning enough to move out and get a new place. And where are the kids in all this, or students? What really is she trying to do?
It's interesting, isn't it? Because a return always feels sort of slightly trapping or enclosing in some way, doesn't it? Like somebody coming back home as well, when they're supposed to have set off. And also the word, I think ruthless is a really interesting word, because it really sort of clashes with the idealistic idea, the concept somehow. But they sort of really somehow, they also really go together, don't they? Because sometimes idealistic people are really ruthless. And they sort of, you know, think about, I don't know, Lenin or something. Do you know what I mean? You can think that big about, but also that there is a real tension between those words, isn't there? And what gets destroyed in a sense, does ruthlessness destroy our idealism? And is that the kind of struggle that she's? So we talked about, remember, kind of the established part of a character, the kind of the character, the way people always have lived and the way they see themselves. And then some kind of event happening, and then the sense that something new starts to emerge, maybe a hidden part of that person, or something that the event or the crisis starts to call out of them, and that kind of tension or friction is something that's unresolved, and it's something about the character's journey, and something that the play, or you as a playwright, is trying to kind of question, like, is it how ruthless you have to be to fulfill your ideals or something? And what are ideals if they turn around and can make you act in a ruthless manner? And what? So there's something really sort of fascinating about that. So that maybe when you're thinking about your scene, and I'll sort of use that as a little bit of a template for everybody, you're thinking about some kind of event, like the event in the Lear scene is Lear demanding of his youngest daughter a kind of a bond or a vow that she doesn't want to make because she feels it's not truthful or fair to her, even though she loves him, which is why she's so... You know, that event is what then splits them apart. So you're looking at an event that somehow also starts to energise that conflict between ruthlessness and idealism, perhaps, for your if that's her central... Because you're looking... All great characters are sort of radically divided, you know... And that's a sort of very interesting sort of division, I think, that you've got there. So it might be that then her story and the story you're looking for that character is something along the lines of idealism and ruthlessness. And like what might, so the question, I mean, you're not probably going to solve the question of the play, but I mean, just for the sense of thinking about a scene, you're thinking of a scene between maybe two people that kind of starts to create that fault line for that character, starts to make, you know, pose that question to that character about idealism, ruthlessness in some way, and it and thinking about, so when you're thinking about your scene as well, it's quite useful to think in terms of what's the ritual that's happening, who expects what, what is the expectation of the scene for the character, and how is it overturned, and what's the revelation, what's the reveal, what's the discovery that makes the character discover that the world's not quite what they thought it was, and that throws those, opens up those emotional territory that's aura and starts to pull the character, pull the conflict of the character. You're sort of pulling it apart in a way, the kind of ruthlessness and idealism sort of thing. What about you? How did you get on with your character?
I was thinking about this girl who, when she was at school, was kind of on track to be a professional sports player and was kind of the star of the school and sort of probably from quite a working class community and was kind of going to do really well sort of financially and in terms of her ambition, who was injured quite early in her career, and so that kind of fell apart for her, and it's her being back in her old world, having kind of disappointing all those expectations on her.
So there's a sort of sense of failure for her, a sense of what's the conflict for her, do you think? Is a sense of resentment,
failure to live up to expectations, I guess, but then what I was also kind of starting to explore was maybe actually she didn't want that thing that she was on that in the first place.
Is it her expectations that she's let down, or is it other people's? Is she trying to find, as you said, you know, she's sort of moving on, you know, okay, this thing hasn't happened, and it's quite a bitter pill to take, but actually, is she then trying to find another way, and it's not necessarily the worst thing that's ever happened, but, so the kind of conflict there is almost like a resignedness with a sense of opportunities that are developing or could develop, perhaps, you know, so how does she... Is it about what she should put up with? You know, I like the story that you had about the meeting of somebody.
Yeah, and then I was kind of imagining she ends up. Yeah. Kind of like, oh, arena football is not very stereotypically female, and then I think being a delivery driver isn't very stereotypically female.
Well, that's quite interesting.
Stores, and that's why it was interesting. That the kind of girl who'd be a footballer, she'd then be the kind of girl who'd be a. And then I wondered if it was someone she was at school with, and it's about how where they are has reversed. Or not, and maybe someone, one of them bullied the other, or I don't know yet what kind of...
Yeah, so what do you think about the kind of, you think about your, is your central character that girl, or is it the girl that, is it the person she encounters, you know, is she, who, I mean, it could kind of be either, couldn't it? And what the, just for the sake of the exercise, you know, what's the division, what's her, the conflict, what's the conflict in the character about? Is it about somebody seeing you, not liking how somebody regards you, because you're not a failure, but they're seeing you as that. Is that a sort of interesting idea? Anyone else want to say anything about their character?
I can do.
Go on then.
Yeah. I mean, I sort of went round that way to get there.
Yeah.
But as you were suggesting, kind of the idea of the finger on the lips and the idea of silencing in terms of certain media not being allowed to go in terms of that story, I tried to sort of deal with those kind of themes but flip it on its head a little bit and think about, I think some kind of woman from Salford recently lost a job and quite angry at the world. And probably a husband probably thinks that each evening she's hidden away applying for jobs, but actually I think she's probably sort of trolling online, kind of this kind of like an alt-right activist to an extent, and trying to change the world in that way.
Right.
And maybe like, I mean, I was going along the lines of kind of showing how because almost these people who have very unpleasant views, like because they've sort of not been tolerated for so long, actually by kind of silencing them.
Yeah.
Then we now have this kind of new kind of political way by silencing them. And in the same way, by trying to silence people today, you'll have the same sort of thing going. So I suppose it's about how you tolerate and not necessarily respect.
So, okay, so there's toleration and respect. I mean, also, what's interesting is she's like a secret alt-right woman, isn't she? So people don't quite know.
She's silencing herself because she knows that what the things that she thinks isn't okay.
Right.
And yet she still thinks those things.
Right.
And is still trying to promote them online.
So in a way, it's sort of about her, that's the emergent side. I suppose is it useful to think about the idea of what's the established her, and then the emergent side is this secret life as an alt-right. So how is that, which she hasn't really explored yet in the world, which is quite interesting. It's kind of, because it's secretive.
Like you were saying earlier on about kind of spaces at the moment, because it's such a private space. Really, an event can't take place with her in a computer. I mean, it could, but I don't think it really can. But until that's thrown into a public space, whether because she's confronted by someone that's close, or the police, or whatever.
Right, okay, well that's quite good. So it's what you've really landed on there is what's kind of emerging. You know, it's a kind of, no one knows about it, she knows about it. What's the first moment that it ever kind of rears its head? Perhaps that's a good idea for a scene. What's the first moment where is a moment where she chooses to keep, like Cordelia, to keep silent or to speak? I mean, that's an interesting idea for a scene for that character.
Yeah.
How about you?
I think those questions actually really helped me with the setting, actually. Especially, I can't remember, but some of them were like, who was there and what was it like to return? And I kind of went with this idea that it was that woman. And from the questions that were asked, so she's got a young daughter who's three, that she is everything to her. And when it was kind of talking about setting and where she was and, you know, how it was different to how she'd come back, I thought of her being in like a shelter type thing, and her pattern is that she goes there, but when she comes back, there's different people there, and there's a conflict then of her obviously trying to escape that situation, and her wanting to look after her daughter, but then that kind of inner conflict, I guess, of maybe wanting to go back.
Right.
So
it's sort of like somebody who is driven to save herself and be in a shelter, like you said, but at the same time is being called back to her old life. How much does she deserve to be free, kind of thing?
Yeah.
Is that the sort of conflict for her? Which is a sort of, is that like a self-esteem issue, how much you deserve something, or is it a fear of the old? One part of you is fearful to break away, another part really wants to. Is that her fault line, do you think, perhaps?
I think so. I think it was more to do with
how you deserve to be free, do you think?
Yeah, because it.
And why you wouldn't take freedom.
Freedom.
Why you wouldn't.
Did come up.
Yeah, so that's like, okay, so that might be her her dilemma in a way, put it like that sort of thing. Okay. Right, so what I'm going to ask everyone to do now, I'm just going to ask you to write. I'm going to give you 20 minutes to, 15 minutes. What's the time now? 20 minutes to write a scene, okay? Just have a go at a scene. So you've got between two characters, one of the one who you've talked about, and this idea that it's some, and it can be, it doesn't have to fit into a play. Don't try to squash your scene into a play. All you're doing is exploring your character with another character and trying to somehow think about what that conflict, how the character's divided, and how all this scene is doing is trying to, in a way, poke at that, sort of worry at that conflict. The scene in some way has to be about allowing the character to understand that they have that conflict in a way, or exploring that conflict. The scene is about exploring the conflict of the character, the way the character's divided. And just think about the ritual, what the revelation is, how the gap opens up between what a character expects is going to happen and what actually happens. I think that's the strongest thing in a scene, you know. A character, either your character or the character they're with, has an expectation about how the scene's going to turn out. And because there's a conflict in the scene, it doesn't manifest itself. It doesn't happen in the way they expect. Have I expressed that myself? Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you haven't got a character yet, think, I'm going to chuck everything away and I'm just going to write a scene where whoever turns up. Do you know what I mean? Because that's another way of just doing it. You don't have to. But I mean, if you have got a character, just try it. It'd be great if you started the conflict started to open up, the internal conflict. But in another way, it can just be your character's in a situation that puts them under pressure. You know, that's all that a scene, all the plays are in some ways, are characters under pressure, until they're under so much pressure that the kind of alchemy of that just it sort of explodes them into a whole new identity, where they Okay, so that's... I'm going to stop there now. So there's a 15-minute break where people are writing scenes. Welcome back. So the scenes have been written and we're going to talk about them a little bit, but also we've got one volunteer who wants to read what they've written. Well done you.
An ordinary suburban house. There's a knock at the door, loud. Daniel winces at the volume. Daniel answers the door. Daniel, can you just, next time, could you knock a bit quieter? The baby, I have mentioned it before. Jenny, I haven't delivered here before. Daniel, no, but I mean your company. Jenny, not my company. Daniel, no, but it doesn't matter, forget it. He reaches for his food. Jenny, how old is she, the baby? 10 months, she's not the best sleeper. Jenny, is she Miss Goldburn's? Daniel, what? Jenny, at school we were all convinced you and her were banging. Daniel, do I know you? Jenny, you had me for maths in year 8. Jenny Malcolm, I wasn't in a lot. Daniel, Jenny Malcolm, the footballer. Jenny, the delivery driver. Daniel, but I thought, Jenny, injury, it happens. Daniel, sorry, I just assumed I don't really follow women's football. Sorry, Jenny, me neither anymore.
Lovely. That's a really nice little scene. I mean, you don't feel like, I suppose what you'd learn is that she doesn't follow football anymore, neither does he. But it's a kind of almost like an introduction to them, isn't it? Hasn't quite pushed on to what you might consider the discovery of the scene yet. But I mean, you only had a short space of time. What I think is really admirable is that I really believe in those characters. I really like, and I really believe the situation. I really believe that she would be delivering at his, there's no question that she might be delivering at her old maths teacher's door. And that that she would recognize him before he recognized her. And then he's kind of catching up in the scene. And also, because I think the questions are, well, what was that relationship like? And then who's banging who? What did she says? She kind of, that's a bit of a cheeky question to him, isn't it? About who the baby whose babies is. And that's a sort of a little bit transgressive. And it's a little bit aggressive, actually, isn't it? It sort of gives us a little bit of a clue about her and about how she isn't going to take it. In a way, she's got some kind of beef on him, or she wants something from him because she started to kind of like chip away at him a little bit. So it's just sort of really interesting about where it's going to go, and also what effect that encounter has on his life. You know, if he's still a teacher, I don't know. You know, and if she was his student, then what's the responsibility? Did he have some kind of responsibility to her? What does his wife know? What is his situation now? Does his wife know about this? Supposed affair that was kind of going on. It's almost a little bit like, is she trying to blackmail him a little bit or something? There's a kind of hint of it in there, isn't there? I mean, I don't know, and it's quite nice if things don't go perhaps where you might expect them to, but it's certainly really strong. I think you really got something with it. I sort of believe in the characters, and if that's good, if from nothing today, just from those two little, that little picture and that little the article that you brought in. And how interesting your article and your picture were kind of in conflict with each other on either side. There were two opposites. We talked about opposites right at the beginning, didn't we? And how interesting that even that little scene has got a kind of two opposites. The person coming in from the cold and the person that's already established with the family. And actually, who's the happier? Maybe that's the kind of question, you know. But it would be interesting to see where that scene might be taken, and if she gets invited into the threshold, or if she turns up again, you know. I love her chippiness about, oh, it's not my company. It's really good. Did you have any idea where it might go?
I was imagining that she might keep turning up.
Right.
Kind of, yeah.
Okay, so
I don't know why yet.
Yeah, okay, that's great. Now, does anyone else want to talk about what they did rather than read it? Did anyone actually finish a scene?
I nearly did.
Did you?
I could talk about.
Yeah. So what? Yeah. Just talk about it and talk about what the reversal was, if you can, or where you were heading to with it.
Okay. So I was imagining it in a shared space, in a cramped space, so sort of a living room, come kitchen, come utility room, and my idealistic teacher, Jan.
Yeah.
She normally marks. Her ritual is marking. It's 4 till 7, but the dad comes in 7 or 5, and she's still there.
Right.
So it's about the dad's interrogation of why she's still there. She must have had a bad day. And she talks that there's this email that's sort of gone round. They're on the lookout. They've got to expel these number of kids. And he's like, you should say something about that. And she's, I mean, you know, she's like, I've got to finish this marking. And he's like, no, you put that marking aside. You can be late with that. And let's, you know, I almost had to like hacking into the emails of the head. Or I mean, that was a bit too far. But just her putting aside the marking of the kids that she likes and stuff to focus on how to take down the head.
What's the conflict in the scene? Because if she goes along with what the dad says, in a sense, because the dad actually sounds like that's where she's got her idealism from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know what his relationship to...
Yeah, he was almost... I mean, yeah, it was weird because he was coming very much as sort of like a pushy parent.
Yeah.
And I could have imagined that's how he was when she was younger.
I mean, he wasn't a teacher, was he?
No, I don't think so.
But he sounds like, I mean, it's quite interesting that he says, well, you know, you've got to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it's so annoying, isn't it? When you know you should be doing the right thing, but you're in a situation where it's really tricky to confront the head. And as you said, that the head's also in a tricky position. They're not a totally evil figure. They're sort of, are they?
Mm-hmm.
But they're choosing to be pragmatic as opposed to idealistic.
Mm-hmm.
And your character, is it Jackie?
Janet
is sort of... you know, there with loads of marking, which, you know, is like soul-destroying kind of piles of marking that she's got to kind of wait
mm-hmm.
to do it, that is hard to do anyway. And the dad's coming there and telling her to do the right thing. I mean, it's as if she just says, yes, okay. But actually, is there a productive conflict there between her and her dad? Like, look, that's all right, just come and sort of say, you know, you've got to do this. But if I don't do this marking, I'll have more marking on Thursday. You know, I'm sick, I've got a headache as it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Stop, why are you pressurising me to be? It might be that there's a kind of, she might refuse, in a sense, to address it at this moment. But it's just, rather than, because I know that your story is that you want her to somehow encounter the head, but within each scene, there has to be a conflict and it has to be,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's quite interesting, isn't it? If something, you see how stressed she is by how much and how difficult the subject is and how difficult her life is, in the sense that she argued with her father, who she obviously loves and respects,
mm-hmm.
but there's some kind of, you know, how awful it is to be told to do the right thing when doing the right thing is really difficult and actually it's not clear what to do, kind of thing. It might be that there's, that, I don't know, just pointing out that rather than just giving her an easy passage, because you have to make your life really difficult for your protagonist, otherwise,
mm-hmm.
and in a sense, you know, and then there's a recognition thing, because it's not easy to do the right thing. You know, we're not heroes, you know, when are we? It's really, you know, she wants promotion, you know, she's not getting it. She wants promotion because she wants to move out of her dad's house, you know. If she challenges the head, where's that going to, is she going to be head of year one? I mean, it's sort of building up just really pushing at the conflict in the scenes, a really useful way of finding the real juice of a scene and really unearthing it. I think that's a great character and a great dilemma, actually. And I think there's really loads there. And, you know, you really feel for, you know, what is an idealist someone to do in a situation that's education now, which is like so difficult,
mm-hmm.
you know. So it's a really urgent, I feel like it's a really urgent play for now as well, which is really good. Does anyone else want to talk about what they did? I'll just check the time, actually. We've got a few. Anyone else want to mention anything?
I can, but not particularly.
Go on then.
Right, no, you can.
Obviously, I insist.
I'll shut up so you can just talk, guys.
I don't really know what to say. My scene didn't necessarily have a ritual, which was, it was nice then going through and thinking, oh yeah, they don't have that ritual where you have expectations and you can
yeah.
subvert them, so it's really useful listening to them, just them. Mine was simply a conversation between, I mean, it's just the conflict that I talked about earlier on between a wife who's pretending to look for jobs, a husband who's desperate for the money, and which is why it's so important that she finds a job, and kind of looking at that conflict. And I also really liked the fact that we had 15 minutes to do it, because otherwise I think I've got some ideas that I reckon I could, you know, kind of explore or take up elsewhere.
I think your alt-right woman mm. who's kept it under tabs is a really good character, actually.
Yeah,
I just like her. I think she's very now, and And weirdly, you have sympathy with her because she's a woman, a silenced woman, even though what's bubbling out of her could be evil and, you know, something something that we find, I mean, I'm calling it evil, but you can't ever, it's not good to think of your character like that in a way. It's good to side with your character. And she may have really, you know, good reason, why challenge
well,
the liberal audience.
It was really useful doing just this as well, like thinking what's the conflict or what's the event or how do you create that conflict?
Yes.
Because when I was talking about it earlier on, I think I was talking like in kind of very broad conceptual strokes about the ideas that I'd like to explore.
Right.
So then all of a sudden, of course, when you actually look at the conflict, you actually start to get who is this person and how do they get to that, to that point.
I think that's a really good point, you know, to actually get down to specifics because you can... abstract, you know, theatre's very concrete in a way. It's very, what people want, where are they? You know, how do they feel emotionally? What's blocking? All that stuff is really opposite of abstract. You can abstract from it as somebody watching, but as a writer, you need to be right in the sort of dirt in a way, don't you?
Yeah.
Great, I'm glad about that. How did you get?
Yeah, mine was same thing really. When as everyone's kind of going through, I was thinking, what's the ritual? What's it? You know, the reveal. What's that going to be towards the end? I think you need to make more of that. But I was just really trying to focus on the conflict and develop the character. So I had this woman that I'd spoken about in this place, and her husband's found her, and he's trying to convince her to.
Brilliant.
It feels like a later scene actually.
Right.
He's trying to convince her to go. And she's kind of saying no, and for the first time, and he's not taking her seriously.
That's a good idea.
But it does feel a bit like it'd be later on, as
or actually maybe not. I mean, actually, why not start at a kind of you know, you really see the situation. It's a real risk, and that real there's a lot of jeopardy in that scene, isn't there? And it really grabs. And it's true. It's like a great scene's a really powerful where someone's trying to persuade someone else to something, and of course, you know. In a way, that will really call on her, you know, has she got the right to stand up for herself, to assert herself? What's the cost? What will the risk be of doing that? And, you know, he's found her. I mean, that's terrifying. It's a really good moment. I mean, you could almost start with somebody being found and how, you know, and will she go back and make the same mistakes? And then what will happen? I mean, it's quite, I think it's an interesting trajectory and journey for you. I think I'm really glad you found that woman. I think that's a really strong story. Mm. You know, people always say it's so easy to leave. It's so easy. Well, is it? You know, it's not easy to leave for anybody, of anything, ever, is it? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's a really good one. And how did you get any art? We were talking a little bit about moving yours to one side, weren't we?
Yeah, well, I mean, I just kind of got a bit stuck because I sort of felt like I had this sort of weird thing going on where I was sort of trying to combine the girl in the photo with the woman in the story and trying to sort of, you know, imagine the woman kind of returning to the country that she'd sort of been left for some sort of traumatic reason and getting all the bits sort of stuck in the sort of the details and sort of feeling like, well, I probably needed to go away and do some research, you know, that sort of thing.
Which you could do if you weren't in a workshop.
Exactly. And then we sort of kind of talked about, you know, maybe that actually the you know the character to think about would be the husband or the son or the daughter-in-law of the woman sort of left behind, left in this country, or perhaps a lawyer or an advocate sort of appealing for her return or something. But again, that was sort of leading me into like what. Need to know what the legal arguments
but
are.
You've almost got a quest story then, haven't you? Which is an interesting structure. Somebody trying to get somebody back and what that quest, you know, what's the story of that quest? And it's quite an interesting structure to have actually in a play.
Mm.
That's interesting.
Yeah. I had another thought when Josh was talking about the ritual and sort of thinking, well, in that situation, what could a ritual be? And, because I've got family overseas and like kind of, you know, having a sort of like a birthday over Skype or something. You
that's
know,
a
kind
great
of really,
idea.
I just kind of had that idea for a possible sort of scene between, you know, sort of trying to make the best of it and trying to have a, you know, celebrate a birthday or some
that's
sort of an event. And
really powerful.
Talking about the elephant in the room.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely. You know. Because actually that is like a contemporary ritual, isn't it? A ritual around someone on Skype. I mean, it's sort of probably not been written very much, but actually it's a really good idea, and it's they're both there and not there, and how people try to make it, normalize it, when it's actually quite painful. It's very powerful. That's a really powerful image. So, so I'll just finish by saying I think you've done amazingly, and thank you for taking part. But I think you've all found something. And in a way, that's all it is. There's no rights and wrongs. It's just trying to find something like that image that suddenly seems to open up the whole play in a way. Or finding a character, finding characters and worlds and relationships. The father, and who knew that the father was going to be like that? Or that Mr. What's-his-face had been humping someone from... Do you know what I mean? It's all fascinating, isn't it? And where it all comes from. So, thanks so much. And thanks, everybody, who's been tuning in. Good luck with your plays. And I've got something else to say, which is that next week... on the 16th of March, the next workshop, where writer Omar El-Khairi will be addressing research and political writing. Good night.